is another question. Usually some Arabs give certain signs of the Imam Mahdi. For instance, his name, his origin from among the Prophet's progeny, being from Arabia. Are these the principal signs for the Imam Mahdi? If not, what are the real signs for the advent of Al-Mahdi?
You see, what are signs? Those who distinguish between one thing and another, or those who confuse things. First, this is what should be understood. If there is a sign, so-called sign, instead of leading you from darkness to truth, it leaves you halfway where you don't know whether it is darkness or truth, then what is the purpose of that sign? Now, these scholars, I call them medievalists. They do not go all the way back to Hazrat Rasulullah Kareem Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam and understand his prophecies in the light of the wisest of prophets, who spoke like Jesus Christ, sometimes in parables, sometimes in metaphors, but stop midway and look at the scholars born during the politicization of Islam in that period, who were very harsh in their attitude, very, you know, sword-minded, trigger-happy people. So they understood Islam in reference to whatever they knew of that age. And the mullahs of today, I don't understand the attitude. Instead of going all the way back to Surah Al-Fatiha and the Quran and trying to infer sensible, acceptable meaning with reference to this age, they return halfway and stop there and say, Mullah said this, Mullah said that, and that Imam said this, and that Imam said that. As he understood, he must have been right. And they destroy the whole thing with reference to the Quran and the Hadith, and they lose the meaning. Now, during that period, many traditions were in rotation. And those traditions, as I understand, if they contradicted each other, they could not be all true. If they apparently contradicted each other and you delve deeper into them, you could have found some system of reconciliation and compromise. But they did not bother about it. These ulama of that age period, they accepted everything verbatim, word for word, exactly everything. And they didn't bother to consider that this will create problems, contradictions, attributed to Muhammad Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam. And they didn't bother to see that these things can happen accidentally as well. How could you believe an Imam to be from God if his name was Muhammad, if his mother's name was Amna, if his father's name was Abdullah, and he belonged to the progeny of Muhammad Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, if he happened to claim to be Imam Mahdi? This is the question. If these are really signs which do not confuse things, then there was exactly such an Imam born in Yemen. Why have you rejected him? Why don't you believe in him? Was it Yemen or Sudan? Sudan. The Mahdi of Sudan fulfilled these requirements. And unfortunately, you know, he met with disaster ultimately and is becoming part of history. So the question is, this is not only the one person, there are others who happen to have fulfilled these criteria. There is one, Maulana Muhammad John Puri of India. He also happened to fulfill this criteria. So if these traditions really speak of distinctive signs, then all Muslims who insist on these traditions must believe first on them. Forget about the Mahdi or the Qadna. But before that, these signs are already fulfilled. Why do they reject them? So when they have rejected the sign, why do they demand this sign from us? The sign which they have already rejected? Now you see the argument. Another example of the same. A few years ago in Mecca, a party of armed men under leadership fulfilled all the requirements of one of the ahadith about the Mahdi. He would make cruise from here, then he'll go and stand by the wall of the Mecca of Khana Kaaba and announce his Mahdiyat from there. And all these things were fulfilled verbatim, letter to letter. You know what the soldiers did to them? They slaughtered them, all of them. Did not spare a single soul. So when a Mahdi fulfills these requirements which you demand from us to be fully literally, you slaughter them. Which Mahdi would you believe in then? You see? Now, another hadith. If you take these hadiths literally, you know what would happen? There is one hadith which tells us that yudfanu mai fi qabri. The Mahdi, and also it is said about Jesus Christ, yudfanu mai fi qabri. Now, it's not by my side. It is fi qabri, mudfanu mai. Maybe misunderstood as by myself, but no, fi qabri, in my grave. Now, they say, ask the mullahs from Pakistan, they many times come and inquire from me. Said, where did Hazrat Mirza Sahib die? Where did he die? I said, in Lahore. Where was he buried? I said, in Qadian. You see, this is hadith. Yud sono mai fi qabri. I said, all right. First of all, tell me, is there any one single Muslim today living who would dare anybody to open the grave of Hazrat Muhammad Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam and bury anyone, whatever he is? He would rather die, slaughtered himself, than permit anybody to dishonor this grave. He said, no. I said, if somebody claims to be a Mahdi, would you permit him? Would you promise him that all right, we'll bury you in that grave? No, what you will say would be a different thing. You say, you are the Mahdi, okay. If you are the Mahdi, you must fulfill the traditions. And that means when you die, if you are buried in that grave, then we'll accept you, not before that. All the life is denied to a man. As a false man, because the hadith is not true. When he dies as a false man, who would bury him in that grave? How else could you fulfill this? Use wisdom, common sense. You know, I can suggest a meaning which applies to which is applied to the touchstone of common sense and human nature. Read so well, so beautiful. When you say somebody is like me in origin, somebody is like me in death, don't oppose them. You can express it that as if my father is his father, my mother is his mother, my name is his name. Don't separate us as far as our birth and coming into the world is concerned. We come from the same source. This is an expression also in other languages. And when you say somebody dies my death, that is a holy death, there is nothing wrong with that. You say as if he is in my grave. In Urdu we say, will you be buried in his grave? Which means that do you have the same end as he has? So this could be the only meaning of these traditions. But they are not signs as separating the confusion from the clear truth, because as I have expressed already, they lead from something to confusion, and insoluble confusion. After that, I'll quote a hadith, which I consider a sign. You can all criticize this if you please. You are invited to do whatever you like.
Can we add to this the saying that he is from my progeny, is from Fatima, my daughter?
Of that, I'll come later. It's a separate question.
Okay.
Because I don't want to confuse it here.